your decision is not good.
Can you hear me? And lead the Tyson team. Production because. Can you give me that?
Yeah, hello everybody. Sanjay Kazdan, I'll be introducing you to the of Tyson, and specifically for those of you who may not be aware about why there is a need for another ecosystem in the first place when there are many already available in the market. And I would also like it to be more interactive so that whenever you have any question and all, you can interact with me. So to start with, I would just like to tell you, I mean, why there was a need of another platform in the first place. So Tyson specifically is not that something which we started new. So its basic component started, I mean, somewhere around 2007, 2008, when Samsung tried to first build a platform based on Linux that we used to call Samsung Linux platform. So when we launched the first product in 2008 based on this Linux platform, maybe probably it was too early for the market. So, I mean, at that time, you had hardly heard about any platforms selling which were specifically based on Linux and which were multitasking and had so many features available at that time. So what happened during the subsequent years is that we had another platform called Bada, which you are aware about. I mean, most of you might have worked with Bada. But Bada was not based on Linux to begin with. And then we launched Bada in 2010. So we saw some success in some of the markets, specifically India as well as Europe. But then Bada also had its shelf life, right? I mean, when we have to probably compete with the platforms like Android or specifically iOS, and Bada being a closed platform and specifically developed only by Samsung, and keeping into consideration a lot of developmental costs, so we at one particular point in time had to decide what we do with it. I know many of you must not have been happy when you heard the news that Bada is discontinued. We still get emails from people, the users of Bada phones are all saying that why did you do it in the first place? Okay. Now, whatever experiences we had with Bada specifically, I mean, we had a lot of voice of customer from Bada, and then we thought, okay, why don't we apply that onto our another platform, which is basically Linux platform, and then maybe try to give a better platform to the users worldwide. But then by that time, the landscape had eventually changed. I mean, when you had to face Android or when you had to face iOS, and Samsung kind of a company coming up with a platform on their own, which will be a closed platform to begin with, so there may not be many takers. So that's why you will see Tyson is basically promoted by Samsung and Intel, right? So now, initially, it is Samsung and Intel, but off late, you will see that Huawei also joined in the Tyson steering committee. So basically, now the point is, when we talk about Tyson, there are three elements which I want to focus on. One is that it is purely web-centric. So like you saw the earlier presentation by the Mozilla just now. So the entire focus of Tyson platform is going to be on web. So we would like developers to write applications which are purely HTML5 based, and we would also like you to be able to monetize them on different platforms. Now, is that sufficient? I mean, if so, then there are many platforms which are coming up, which are web-centric. For example, Firefox is one of the operating systems which is coming and which is also promoting web specifically. Then what else could be there in addition to being a web-centric platform? Now, what we have seen specifically with Android and with iOS is that both the operating systems actually are in one of the way closed operating systems. I mean, iOS and all is purely dominated and controlled by Apple. And Google, even though OEMs can use it, but then the decision of what comes in which release and all is purely taken by Google itself. So one of the reasons you will see why Tyson is an open-ended platform And why there is something called the Tyson Association, which is going to drive all the decision making, is to ensure that there is no single entity which will have the overall control of the Tyson operating system in the first place. So if you go specifically and if you see the competitiveness of Tyson platform, the first thing specifically we are talking about is source code. So the entire development of Tyson platform will be open sourced. That means not only that we will be using some of the open source components. I mean, if you see Tyson specifically, it uses something called EFL. Many of you may be aware about there is something called EFL as the windowing subsystem and canvas. That's an open source project and we have taken that. Then it is also using X11 as the windowing subsystem. Then it's also using WebKit2, which is an open-ended web engine. So basically, if you see all the fundamentals of Tyson platform will be open source. Now, when we are going to take a lot of components from open source and all, so it is imperative that we should also involve developers into developing the platform. So we have already released Tyson 2.0, but from Tyson 3.0 onwards, any one of you can come and start participating in developing the platform itself. It is open in the JIT. There is an open JIT available as of now, wherein you can come forward and go to the Tyson Association and say that, yeah, I am willing to contribute to the platform itself, not only as an application developer. Not that you have to just go to the SDK and use some API and develop an application and sell it, no. Even in the development as well, you can come and contribute. So that is basically when we say source code open. Now, we say Android also, the code is open, but you will not be able to decide on what should come, for example, in the KitKat release, right? You will not be able to decide that, Google only will decide. Similarly, if you go to Windows Phone, it's proprietary, and iOS, I mean, there is no question to even come to that discussion. Then when you come to App Store and all, and if you see today on the Android side and all, there is a lot of fragmentation in the App Stores. Like every OEM is trying to build their own App Stores, right? And every other service company, specifically, let us take the example of Open Mobile, right? Open Mobile also has their own Android store. So there are so many Android stores available now. So you really don't know from where to pick what. Of course, Google's App Store is the most famous one, but we would definitely like the situation to change. We would not like to have so many app stores in the first place, because the problem is when an app store is dominated by a particular entity, that's where there is a need to open up your own app stores, because everybody wants the pie at the plate, right? So why specifically, for example, when you say, let's take the case of Samsung itself has an app store on Android as well, right? So now, specifically when a user is buying a phone and all, he sometimes gets confused whether I should download this application from this store or where, and so that's what we call fragmentation specifically. So, but that how is it going to be different in case of Tyson and all? Our App Store is going to be governed by Tyson Association, and we will tell you who are the members of the Tyson Association. I mean, if you see, specifically if you see current board members of Tyson Association are Vodafone, Orange, Docomo. Of course, these are driven by operators. Then we have Korea Telecom, we have LG, we have SK Telecom. Then there are currently many vendors who have already supported Tyson, Samsung, Intel, Huawei, Panasonic, Fujitsu. And off late, you see, Huawei has joined even in the steering committee. That means all the decisions that need to be taken into what should constitute Tyson 3.0 or beyond, what should be the roadmap, what should be the strategy, will not be decided only by Samsung. It will be decided by Samsung, Intel, Huawei, and then the implementation of that roadmap or what features you would like to take, even the developers also can come and start contributing. So that way, this is going to be a new paradigm shift which you will not see in the existing platforms. Of course, how successful it will be depends on, I mean, how successful the model itself evolves into. But if you see the presentation given by Mozilla as well, I mean, whatever effort Mozilla is trying to do or WebKit is trying to do is to basically take the shift towards open source, take the shift towards where the developer itself has a say into not only the platform but also into the application development ecosystem. So one example I just wanted to give you here is, honestly, I mean, if you see, I mean, Samsung kind of a company, for example, you would not have heard about Samsung probably coming out with a platform like this where we talk about so much open source, everybody's involvement. Not that Samsung wanted to be a philanthropist and say that, no, we want to do good for everybody in the world. I mean, that's not the case in the first place. But how different you want to be from the existing ecosystem is what is pushing us into this domain. So recently, actually, we were in one of the conferences on the vehicular, I mean, IVI kind of a segment in Barcelona, and where you get surprised, I mean, companies like BMW and General Motors are coming and saying, we have a lot of code which we have written for our cars and for vehicles from 30, 40 years and all. We are all ready today to open it up. Because if we don't open it up and all, somebody else will open it up and then it will get market acceptability and then we will die eventually. So today nobody can even think of, oh, maybe probably is there a reason why Apple has to die one day? But then there are many commentators and all who say, if you continue to be as closed as possible, there is a lot of anger, frustration, not only with developers, but also with the end users saying that, why, for example, one of the examples you are saying is why I should buy another device if I have to probably use another browser version? Or why is it so difficult to transfer data from my Apple iPhone to another phone which my wife uses? Probably your wife may not use same iOS, right? Why is it not possible for these OEMs to come together and perhaps have a common interface where they can make our life easier, right? So that is the frustration which is slowly building up. I'm not saying that it's going to explode tomorrow, but this is what we have seen, and many traditional companies, which, I mean, until recently will not even open even a single bit of their code and all, coming and saying that, yeah, we are ready to open up, right? So in that segment and all, if you see, it is a big transformation for Samsung as well, where we come and in such form we say that, yeah, we really want to share our entire code, all the developmental efforts which Samsung Intel together has done from many years and all will be opened up for you to see and update and enhance, as I said, from the platform point of view. Now, if you come to this specifically, as I said, I think in my opening comments itself, I explained specifically web. So what Christian was saying above was that one of the platforms and all where he has seen the best web score is BlackBerry. It was true some time back and all. So you all have the browsers availability. If you just go and search now and see which operating system or which platform has the highest HTML5 score, it will be Tizen, and it's 492 out of 500. You can just check it. Second is BlackBerry, of course. Maybe his intention was to probably compare those platforms which are already available in the market, because Tizen product not being available in the market, probably he might not have included, but you can check it out. So why we are saying this is when our focus of the Tizen and entire Tizen focus is on web, HTML5, JavaScript, CSS, right? So in such a case, our first priority is to see what kind of environment we can give, development environment, development ecosystem, web framework, to the developers, so that when they write an application, which of course may be compliant to HTML5, but what about performance, right? What about those device APIs with which you would like to control the device hardware, the sensors, the gyroscope, right? So it's of course not sufficient that, yeah, we say that we are HTML5 compliant and we have 100% W3C compliant APIs available. But those W3C APIs may not give you access to the camera, right? Because if you see, the standardization in those areas is so slow, probably, to be very honest and all, it's not slow because it takes time, it is slow because it is deliberately made slow. I mean, nobody would like, for example, today, if you tell me if the existing app stores, for example, iOS or Android and all, are so popular and all, why would they like happily one day you to come up with an Angry Bird application which can run on all the platforms in the world? Then how can you write an application only for iOS, right? I mean, when Facebook comes and says that we will write an application only for Facebook, only for Apple, right? And there is a separate version of Google Map application coming for Facebook only, for Apple only, or for example, Samsung only. So why is it? Because inherently OEMs wanted this fragmentation to be there. Otherwise, what difference I can make? I mean, how can I be different from you? So I can be only different if I allow standards to be 100% compliant and all, right? Then the only differentiation I can make in the hardware, okay, how best my hardware is. And you know today, even if an Apple phone or a Samsung phone is made and all, where from the hardware comes most of the hardware components, right? So the differentiation can be in the software and all, but that's where traditionally it is kept that, okay, whenever somebody comes and says that we want to discuss an API, how I can get an access to a parameter, for example. And then you can see how the discussions go and how much time it takes and all. And by that time, what happens is, the developer gets frustrated, So what he will choose is he will choose one of the device API which is available in, for example, Tizen or Firefox and all, right, his application. Now he will wait for standard to come up, it will not come up. Then eventually he has to port, next day he decides, I want to port this application to Android, then he has to make the changes, make the customization. That's how the market has been consistently running. So when we say that our web score is the best and all, right? Because when we are promoting Tizen as an HTML5 open standard based, so which means our web engine, web core, our web framework performance has to be the best. So that's why, as I mentioned, 492 is the HTML5 score and BlackBerry is very close, 485. Now, if I'm saying that, okay, W3C standards is taking time, right? It's not possible for you guys to write an application today which can straight away fit into another operating system tomorrow. Then you will say, okay, what do we do? Okay, when is that going to happen? Honestly speaking, in 2011, we thought that by 2012, the entire W3C standardization will be complete and then we can really give away all the Flash, all the Adobe things and all, and we move to HTML5. It did not happen. It did not happen in 2013. It will not happen in 2014 as well. Two reasons. If you see, the hardware itself is also evolving, right? It's not that, okay, we will keep hardware fixed and say, okay, we will write all the standards and then one day they will get complete. While standardization is moving with its own pace and all, the development at the software side, at the hardware side are also, I mean, going very fast. So I don't know when they will actually converge and then we can say that, yeah, now I can write an HTML5 application which will run seamlessly across different platforms. And that is the reason why PhoneGap and Open Mobile kind of companies are coming up and they are giving you their own solution and start selling their own components. So what we decided in Samsung is that, okay, for example, my goal is not only to make a platform and say it is ready, available, anybody can come and write an application, any OEM can come and make a phone with it. By the way, if you can see, there is one slide where it will show that this particular platform, like Google and all, will be taken by many other OEMs. It will not be only Samsung or Intel who will make products with it. There will be other OEMs who can come, take the platform, make phone available with it. But then what do we do? For example, tomorrow, Tizen platform is ready now. We are going to come up with the first product in November. Now, let's assume another OEM comes and says that I will use this, right? So they take the platform and then they make some web apps and all and they try to sell it. But knowing that the web performance is not what we want today. Okay, so one of the examples could be, you have seen already Firefox is launched, right? Firefox was launched in Europe and all. You can go and check the reviews, the performance of those web apps and all. It's not I'm saying that, oh, there is inherently a problem in the Firefox. That's not the case. The problem is, if you have an application which is remotely based on some weather kind of data and all, where only feeds come from one side, where you don't need access to the hardware and all, they will work fine. But when you go and you have, for example, a Facebook application where you want to get a handle of the camera and then you want to start a video chat, then you see the performance, right? Now, what we thought is, if we go ahead with web and keep on beating the drum, and if web standards are taking time, so one way is we give our own device APIs. So you will see significant amount of device APIs available from Tizen. But then the slogan of, when I go to the developer and say that you will use the platform, write an application which will work on another platform also, that will not be the case. That's one part A. And part B is, even if I give device APIs, if the performance is not what end user actually demands and all, do I want to kill Tizen straight away and say that, yeah, I will focus only on web and all? Yes, my goal will still remain that it will be web-centric, it will be HTML5. But until that meeting matures and all, what do? Shall I keep waiting? No. So that's why if you see, Tizen will give you three kind of interfaces. I think it's mentioned in the first slide or somewhere, where it specifically says, maybe, can you go back? You can come forward. Yeah, one more. Anyway, so the point I'm trying to make is that you can write a web application with it, with whatever I said, 492 score, the web kind of atmosphere we have given. And in addition to this one, you can also write an application based on native C++ interface. Okay, so all those guys who do not want to write an HTML5 or are not familiar with HTML5 or do not want to move from a traditional C, C++ kind of an interface, we have a very well-defined SDK available. where you can write an application using C++, and then that C++ application will give you that performance which you need. So maybe at the same time when you talk, so for all those complex applications which you want to write where the performance is very, very important, we still give an option to write a C++ application. Second advantage is all the applications which we had written for Bada, which were available, which developers had written. So because we have changed the operating system from a traditional one to a Linux one, but we have managed to maintain the API signatures and the API compatibility. So which means an application which was written in Bada will need to be just recompiled and it will work on Tizen as well. That much we have managed to maintain. That means most of the applications which were there in the Bada store will directly move to the Tizen store. So we are contacting those developers directly and telling them, okay, this is the way you can compile, or you can just give me the source code, I will compile and I will put it through the store and go through the certification. So these are the two, and then there is another interface available for a pure native application to write, which will be based on C and EFL. The highest performance application in Tizen will be that EFL application, because the only difference which we are trying to show from UI point of view is nobody else in the world is using EFL. So you can expect that our UI interface, the look and feel, the richness will be different from Windows, from Apple, from Android. Otherwise, if I make another kind of a UI which looks a mix of this and that and all, so people are not going to buy it in the first place. So three kind of interfaces available: C, there's a C++ interface, and there is a web HTML kind of interface. So all these kind of application ecosystems are existing in the Tizen, and there are different kinds of SDKs available. The only difference is the native C one is not available to developers, right? For developing an application, that is purely given as a maybe advantage to all those OEMs who would like their pet applications. For example, if Orange tomorrow comes and says that Orange Wallet is the best application which is selling in Europe, and people have got a very good feel and experience while using that application on their existing platforms, probably we may suggest to them that, okay, this application we can port as a pure native C EFL based because the performance is guaranteed. And we are also sure that Orange does not want that application to be a downloadable kind of thing, because that's why they probably must be making some money. So basically what I'm trying to tell you is that we have taken care of OEMs very well, because OEMs will be part of the decision making body. They can decide how Tizen roadmap will look like. OEMs also will get the source code open. They will also get the reference design applications which are already available in the Tizen store. And then it will be easy for them to make a phone, because they have all the ecosystem, all the applications, everything ready. And on top of that, if they have some of their key applications which they want to protect and want to for the users to feel them better and all, then they have another way of actually packaging them with the phone. So they will be native icons available, not downloadable, but written in EFL, because that part of the interface, that part of the middleware is very close to the hardware. So these are some of the advantages of Tizen. Then another important part is that while if you see the penetration of Android and Apple OS and all, initially was targeted for smartphone kind of devices and tablet kind of devices and all, the Tizen at the same time is targeting cameras, TVs, tablet PCs as well as the IVI segment. So Intel is very, very keen and aggressive on launching Tizen on the vehicular side. So you will see after some time the dashboards in the car, many of them with Toyota and some of the companies will be launching with Tizen. Then Samsung has already launched a camera, NX300 with Tizen. You can just have the review available on the net. And then smartphones is the focus, of course. So all the OEMs who are talking to us as of now are focusing on smartphones. So basically what we are trying to tell you is that this platform will be a multi-device kind of a platform, and each device category has been taken into consideration while designing and developing the platform. What kind of UI, what kind of format, what kind of resolution, what kind of OS is needed. I mean, the car may need a lower kind of OS, what kind of chipset, so those kind of things have been taken into consideration. And this slide is basically just trying to showcase that why it is probably not so easy for developers to get that much money on the Android. So one of the reason I'm attributing it to the kind of fragmentation which is happening on the Android. That is basically that last point is trying to make it. But then once Tizen gets into such a stage where many OEMs come up and they start using the platform in the first place, and there will be some kind of fragmentation which is unavoidable anyway. But from the App Store point of view, if you can still manage and restrict it to a single kind of App Store and all, so we are still seeing that at least the app level of fragmentation can still be less. Not that the same version of application is developed by another developer next day and it keeps it free on another App Store and you have access to that as well. Those kind of things probably will be taken care of. Yeah, this is basically just trying to tell that, okay, there are only two ecosystems available as of today. They are controlling almost 86 to, almost the entire market is captured by them. So there probably is a need and there is also an appetite for many other operating systems to come. Probably they should be able to differentiate themselves. So in that sense and all, Samsung has also welcomed Firefox and Chrome coming into this picture, because all of them at the end are trying to say that they will be web focused and all. So that's where probably Tizen's primary goal is. Yeah, next. Okay, so most of it we have already covered here. Every ecosystem or every platform will of course have these selling points and all that, what we want to do for our developer and how we want to help in monetizing these applications to begin with. And by the way, I just wanted to highlight here, and there's a Tizen app contest going on currently. There's a Tizen app contest going on currently for around $4 million prize. Yeah, okay. So you will be covering that specifically. If you are interested, you can get into that. Next. So this is basically the key point here is specifically that Tizen store will be monitored and maintained by Tizen Association. So if anybody feels that okay, tomorrow Samsung may decide to tweak, okay, which kind of application will go, which kind of application to restrict and all, that will not be Samsung or Intel's decision and all, that will be Tizen Association. So the entire framework of Tizen development is done and run by Linux Foundation and Tizen Association. So it's not that okay, Samsung can tomorrow say that yeah, this is my way and you have to follow it. So that is actually the primary part. And the second part which I want to highlight here is that we know that one of the biggest challenges we had when we were having the Vada App Store was that developers had to, there was a long process of actually going through the certification. But Tizen Association itself is guaranteeing 3 days. They're guaranteeing that 3 days of certification for an app the moment you actually load it into the App Store will be guaranteed. That means within 3 days, your application can see the day so that it can be available for download and to the seller's office. Next. This is what that particular slide is covering. So validation within 3 days is what we will be guaranteeing. And of course, so another big issue is in terms of billing and all. I'm sure that Chandu will be covering that in detail. What kind of billing interfaces we have, credit card, operator, in-app and all. So all those things will be taken care of the operating system. So at the end of the day, of course, this is again, how easy it is for you to get money out of it. How do we actually rank the applications and how applications are discovered in the first place? So all that ecosystem is readily available as of now. So when we launch the first device by November and first week of December and all, so you'll get a feel of how Samsung phone will actually look like, and then probably you may get more interested into involved into development of applications specifically. So that more or less covers my presentation. If you have any specific question or any doubt specifically, I will be glad to answer that.
Is there any device today that can purchase applications from the Tizen store, or is that yet to come?
So this is the article. Yeah. So actually, as of now, as I said, the first Tizen device is going to come in December timeframe. But at the same time, we had, whenever we have these developer conferences, we had one in May in San Francisco, and there will be another in October in USA, and we didn't have anyone as of now in India. So therefore, all the participants and all, we had actually given them one device. So where they can actually come and write their applications. But at the same time, I think Chandu will be able to help you. He will cover it separately. Maybe if you can answer him now itself, if he wants some access and all. Is it possible through our RTL or something like that? I don't know.
Yeah.
You can build your application using SDK. You can test that application on the device connecting through the internet. So I'll be showing the demo of that, how to connect that. So it covers 70-80% of the applications which are coming out. But if you have an application which requires a hardware feature or like it requires an accelerometer, kind of a things which you cannot do it remotely, then please talk to me. We'll try to help you. Maybe we'll lend a device and those kind of things.
When I write an application today, I have to order for it to be purchasable. Right? I have to wait for the market to the device to come to keep the stock.
Right. You are right for that. But if you want, what his answer was that if you want to experience how an application can be developed with Tizen, and one is that you use the simulator emulator which is available with the SDK. If you still do not have the device and you still want to see how it actually looks on the device, so we have an RTL interface available where remotely you can exactly test it, verify and see how UI look and feel everything runs. And then obviously Tizen Store will soon actually start accepting the application, because the entire concept of having these developer conferences and then giving devices is that we need applications to come onto the App Store. Yes, the point is when they will go for the sale is only when the first device will be available by year end.
Now for developing purpose, the Tizen Association has separate developer units that is called the reference devices. You can request through the developer site. So they will be based on the device availability, they will distribute.
So adding to the particular question about the device availability and the revenue generation, if it's more towards the monetization aspect. So see, Android covers say 60-70% of the market in the slide, but the revenue aspect is not the same. Okay, it's a mass market and then there's a niche market. So generation of that is a little bit different in terms of generating money. I hope that makes sense. Any other question?
Okay, then we go to the next session.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sanjay. Next up, we have Chandu. He is a senior technical manager with developer relations for Samsung India. And he'll be taking us through the Tizen remote test.